The RLDS Church went through and they ended up changing their name to the Community of Christ Church. In the process of doing that, they ended up changing some of their doctrines. And in Ellsworth was where we dealt with a lot of our LDS people, and it caused a massive schism in the church. And like, there's one island called Stonington Dare Isle that you would drive around the island and you'd see Community of Christ Church. Half a mile down the road, you'd see the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints Restoration Branch. Another half mile down the road, the restored, reorganized Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And you had all these different churches on the island. And they were all broken off of the RLDS church because they felt that when it was reorganized to become the Community Christ Church, that there were parts of it that they did not agree with that were changed. And so it was really interesting as a missionary to try to figure out what each of these small little sects believed, and then to try to help approach them, to try to, you know, share the gospel with them and see what you could do with them. The thing that struck me the most was how, like, we would work together sometimes. Like, I know in Machias, Maine, they, when they're looking for a place to hold church, the local RLDS church actually allowed them to hold services in their chapel. And that's something that you're just like, wait, what? The RLDS church allowed the LDS church to use one of its buildings? Shouldn't that be the other way around, maybe? But it was amazing because they were friendly. And I remember vividly, there was one of our investigators we were teaching who was going to the RLDS church. And she's like, I want to invite you to my wedding. I'm like, yes, you're getting married. And she goes, it's going to be the RLDS church. I'm like, that's going to be interesting, especially because we're hoping to commit you to baptism next week. And so we end up going to this church and everyone has this look of, what are the missionaries doing here? And it struck me for two things. First, how old everyone was. I noticed that we were the youngest people in the room. There were probably maybe there were four kids other than us or younger than us, but other than that, everyone was a lot older. And that hit me because I was used to, you know, the Ellsworth, you go to that branch, you go to the primary, and there's just kids everywhere. You're like, good night, how many kids does that one family have? And there's like just running all over the place to go to this church. And it was almost as if there's something there that wasn't being able to keep the youth. And it was interesting because after the wedding, the priest there is like wanted to introduce us to everyone. So he's like, everybody, we have special guests. And I'm like, uh-oh, how's this going to end? And he's like, Elder Goff and Elder Hansen, stand up, stand up. These are my guests. These are our guests today. Treat them good. And they're like, so what are you doing here? And it's like really awkward. We're teaching the people that you just married, because we're hoping to help them to join our church instead of come to your church. And we're at your church right now, so it's kind of awkward. But it was really amazing because they were extremely friendly. I mean, they had one of the men who was over the region for the RLDS church who was there. And he came up to us and he goes, I'm the equivalent to a 70 in the RLDS church. And he just sat down with us and talked with us for like 20 minutes. And we had one lady come up to us and she goes, we believe the same thing. Whereas the Community Christ Church does not believe what I believe. I was raised believing in Joseph Smith, believing the Book of Mormon. I believe these things are true. And she looked around the room, she goes, most everyone here still believes that. So no matter what you hear about if our church has sworn off Joseph Smith or said the Book of Mormon is an actual scripture, she goes, most of the members still believe it is. And that was something that struck me because I'm like, how could a church sustain itself if the members of the church don't believe in what the church says it believes? And it was just something that kind of was like very interesting. And I realized that's probably why the youth in the church aren't there. It would be very hard to raise your kids saying, this is what we believe. This is what I was taught growing up. This is what we believe. And then go to church and have it taught, well, this is kind of ish how, what the direction we're going in. We're potentially going to recognize same-sex marriage in our church. And the kids are like telling their parents. Their parents are like, no, the church doesn't believe in that. And they're like, what is true and what is not true? And it really was interesting because our investigator had an issue with that. We came over to his house and we're like, Carlos, how's it going? And he was livid. And he goes, does your church believe this too? And we're like, well, what do you mean? He goes, their church said that they're going to recognize same-sex marriage as something that is accepted in the church. And I don't believe that. I grew up evangelical. The Bible says no. He goes, what does your church believe? And it was amazing because we were able to sit back and we're like, well, the same thing that God said since the beginning. We're supposed to love them, but marriage is between a man and a woman. And we gave him a copy of the Family Proclamation in Spanish, and it was amazing to be able to testify to him and tell him, this is true. It has been true, it is now true, and it will always be true. And you see right here where it says, it is ordained to God and is one man and one woman. That is what a marriage is. A marriage is when a man and a woman come together. And he's looked at us and he's like, your prophet's not going to stand up and change it on you. And we're like, no, there's consistency. This is how it works. This is how our church works. This is how the prophet works. It's not whatever is convenient. It's whatever is true. And so it was really cool to see him because he's like, I'm going to tell the minister about that this Sunday. I'm like, oh, this is going to be awkward. But it was definitely an interesting experience to serve around so many RLDS people and to see them and to realize how much they love the Book of Mormon, how much they love the Prophet Joseph. And then something that struck me with their church that I think that we could learn from is how much they admired Emma. And it was amazing to see that, they take the verses where God calls her an elect lady and they treat it like what that means. They don't ever talk down and smack about Emma. But sometimes within our church, we're like, well, Emma did stay behind in Nauvoo and this and that. But I'm like, the prophets have said pretty clearly that Emma, we have no right to judge her. She kind of went through a lot with her husband being murdered and everything. And that was something that really struck me was I'd never seen growing up that level of admiration for Emma as I did in the RLDS community. And it made me want to study it and learn and find out what the prophets said about her. And when what the prophets said about her lined up with how they treated her, I realized that maybe the culture that I was raised needed to be changed a little bit to line up with what our prophets were teaching about how to treat her. And so that was something I learned from the RLDS church that was definitely an eye-opener. So one of the interesting things about the RLDS church is that some point in Nauvoo is when they break off from what our church believes. They believe the word of wisdom was given, but they believe that it was just a suggestion. It was later on when the saints were in Utah that the prophets it's come the day for every member to live the word of wisdom. They don't believe that. They still believe it's a good idea, but they look at it and they're like, well, Joseph ran a bar out of the Nauvoo house, so it's okay to drink. And so it was really interesting, just the cultural differences as you're trying to teach them. And people are like, oh, I know the Mormons. The town drunk's a Mormon. And you're like, the town drunk is not a Mormon. He's an RLDS member. But where is he? We want to talk with him. It was really, it was definitely interesting. I mean, it was comforting to read the Book of Mormon that they printed because whereas the chapters were different, the text was the same. And in their Doctrine and Covenants has completely, there's a point where it just branches off and it has bunch of different revelations in their Doctrine and Covenants that separate from ours. And so that was very interesting to try to study that and to try to find the differences, because until you found the differences, you couldn't teach them the correct doctrines. Because if they're holding on to something that's not true, they won't be willing and able to embrace the full truth. They don't believe in polygamy. They don't believe that it was ever supposed to be instituted. It ever was instituted by Joseph Smith. They believe that Brigham Young lied about that. And so it definitely made it interesting because they'd ask you, was Joseph Smith a polygamist? And you're like, well, yes. And like, no, he wasn't. That's a lie that was perpetrated by people after he died. He was never polygamous. He was only married to Emma. He was always faithful to her. And it was just something that I was kind of like, historical fact show otherwise. But it is interesting, especially trying to help explain to them why it was important for it to be restored and why it started, why it ended, and why that was necessary, and why we don't do it anymore. And so that was definitely fun.